韩文题这样。
我听得懂韩文题。
好，好，了解。
对，因为我们之前都是英文唱歌，在那个培训班。
Hello everyone. My name is Noé Mandel. I'm director of the Scottish Documentary Institute, and it's with great pleasure that today we are having another Q&A with a Taiwanese filmmaker, Soong-Hong Lien. Now, we've in collaboration with Taiwan kind of film festival EDINBURGH, we've been holding those talks and trying to discover as much as possible new talent in Taiwan. So Soong-Hong Lien is the director of The Mountain. I hope you've seen the film. If not, please kind of, you know, get back to the website and try to catch it. It's a beautiful poetical film. It's very lyrical about the indigenous people in Taiwan. Soong-Hong is someone who has great sensitivity in terms of how he approaches kind of, you know, characters, but his visual language is very beautiful. And I think it probably comes from the fact that he also works as an editor. So it's easy to see that he's directing and editing in his head at the same time. But we will kind of, you know, explore more of that when we actually ask questions directly to Soong-Hong. So to start with, I will go through a list of questions. And then, hopefully, my dear audience, you can start typing questions in the Q&A and the chat. And we will come and read them out and try to answer. So, to start with, welcome, Soong-Hong. It's lovely having you here.
Hello, everyone. My name is Soong-Hong Lien. I'm a director from Taiwan. It's very pleased to meet you all. And I hope that we could have a good time during this period.
It's always a strange time, but we have a good time. So just to say, the film, The Mountain, you've won many different awards for it. I mean, you know, special jury, kind of, you know, Chinese documentary award. You've won kind of grand prize in South Taiwan kind of film festival. You've won the grand prize in, I mean, it goes on kind of, you know, several awards and all very well deserved. It's a very special story because you actually kind of filmed your grandfather. So it's a very intimate kind of, you know, story as well as being a personal story. To start with, I'd like to know what the challenges were in filming your own grandfather.
Okay, the following question I will answer in the Mandarin, because I'm afraid that some of the...
Quite all right, we love listening to foreign languages.
Okay, then... 第一个问题是... 那个我拍摄我外公最难的挑战是什么？ 那第一个当然是关于语言的问题了， 因为我的母语没有那么好， 所以当我在拍我外公的时候， 很多的时候， 在最初都需要有人帮忙翻译。 然后当然你不可能， 因为我拍了总共2年的时间， 你不可能每次都要找人翻译， 所以到最后我也得要去学一些基本的单词， 然后再加一些比手画脚， 然后去 我们就后来慢慢的就比较可以去沟通，这个是第一个比较难的地方。
好，来，
So there were numerous challenges when he was making this film. The first one is about the language, because he is fairly rusty to the native language spoken by his maternal grandfather. And so a translator was required during this project. So he was working closely with a translator in the beginning of this project. But in this two-year project, it is impossible to work with a translator all the time. And so he forced himself to learn some vocabularies of Telugu, and he also used sign language and body language in order to communicate with his maternal grandfather.
Mm-hmm. 走两三两，就会在那个山上待到三四天左右。那我当然自己会先去尝试，那可是要当要带着一些剧组的人上去的时候，他就得要经过一些训练吧。所以在前一两次的时候，我都是我们都没有带任何的摄影器在上去，就是只是纯粹去爬爬山啊。然后到后来，等他们习惯了之后，再带着器材。不过当然还是。 对他们来说非常沉重，因为16厘米的机器加上底片，是对大家来说都是一个很重的一个负担吧。所以其实很多时候都很像在做那种体能训练，像当兵一样。
So the question, the second difficulty is the environment, because the village where his maternal grandfather lives is far away from Taipei. Mm-hmm. And so he needs to travel down to the east side of Taiwan in the mountains and stay there, spend 3 to 4 days each time during the shooting. And so it is a little bit difficult to bring the film crew to the remote part of Taiwan. And as a result, the training was required in the beginning of this project. The first two visits, no equipments were carried in their visits, and because some kind of physical training was required. And eventually they brought 60 millimeter camera, film camera, and with other equipments with them. Ayuma?
除了这两个之外，应该没有太多的难题。
Yeah. So please move on to the second question.
So why did you decide to shoot on 16 mil when you already had so many physical challenges?
在一开始的时候，我还是用数位的机器去做拍摄的。那我大概拍了一年左右。那这段期间呢，就是我们有时候用那些数位的器材，都会养成一个坏习惯，因为基本上你的可以拍摄的。 的素材是基本上没有限制，只要你有够多的硬碟都没问题。那在，所以那个时候就我外公不管做什么我都要去拍，然后他讲什么我都要去拍。那我在剪接的时候就发现，这样子的节奏其实并不像他的生活的样子。但是就是那个摄影机的运动太快太急了，其实不符合当地的氛围吧。嗯。
In fact, he used digital facilities when in the first year when he started this project. But he eventually found out digital camera made him into a greedy filmmaker trying to capture everything his grandfather did and spoke. But he also felt this kind of a fast method cannot do the justice to the slow rhythm of the village and the line where in which his grandfather lives, and also the way of life his grandfather conducts. And so he decided to move on to the 16 millimeter film camera.
后来我就跟我的摄影师讨论这件事情，然后他就给我看了一个老人，然后在亚马逊河上面划船，他就很单纯的把摄影机放在船头，然后慢慢的拍着那个船沿着河前进，然后就那个印象很美吧，所以我就觉得我就跟他讨论说，我们是不是也可以采用类似的方法去做拍摄，所以在第二年开始的时候吧，我跟他的拍法基本上就是，我们把摄影机架在一个位置，然后远远的去观察我外公在做什么。当然，要这样子做也很仰赖第一年我们有的那些经验，我们就基本上知道他会在这个时间点做什么动作，就是多了很多的预判的可能性，所以才有比较多的时间去准备，然后用自流里面的机器好好拍摄。
And he was working with a Spanish photographer at that time, whose name is Miguel Martinez. And Miguel Martinez showed him a footage he filmed in Amazon rainforest, which an old man is rowing the boat down the river. And he was very impressed by the tranquility and the beauty of the footage. And as a result, he decided to move on to the 16mm film camera. And he and the photographer decided to use motionless camera movement and to have a lengthy observation of his grandfather's everyday activities. And of course, some research and some diary taking was required in order to grasp a full understanding of his grandfather's daily routine.
Mm-hmm. So how did you work with your DOP? Because it's, you know, that would be two of you not speaking the language of your grandfather. Were you not frightened that it may create even more distance with him as opposed to be more intimate?
我跟我的摄影师合作方法基本上，因为他当然他在台湾住了一阵，他的中文很好，所以我们之间的沟通并没有太大的问题。那主要的就是我们在跟我的外公沟通的时候，要怎么样就达到那个我们能够呈现最好的效果。那其实我们尽量能够做到就是不要去干扰他啦，其实也就是这么简单的，我们尽量让他在把他带到一个他熟悉的场域，然后观察他会做什么样的事情，就其实是非常简单的做法吧。
Right. So there was no language barrier between the director and the filmmaker. I mean, the director and the photographer. Because the photographer, Miguel Martinez, was living in Taiwan for some time when they were working together. However, there was some kind of a language obstacle between photographer and director on the one side and the documentary subject on the other. And so they agreed. They don't want to impose any disturbance on the everyday life of his grandfather, but use the camera to have a very lengthy and close observation in an environment familiar to the subject. Okay?
Yeah. Okay.
我可以继续吗？就是
So he wants to continue, okay?
这基本上在拍摄的时候是有延续的一个电影的流派，叫做真直接电影吧。就是基本上就是他讲究就是fly on the wall 那样的，就是、墙上的苍蝇那样子的概念。那我们很想要达到那个境界，但实际上很多时候还是没有办法的。后来就慢慢的去就没有再管这个框架了。
Right. So basically, he followed a school in the motion picture, a concept, he said, I quote, something like to film flying on the wall. So basically, to film the things the way they are. So he employed this idea in his documentary making. Okay?
Yes.
Okay. So when you started developing the idea, was it the idea of making a film about the indigenous community first, or was it a film about your grandfather? Which one came first?
应该是我的外公先。 在最初的时候，那个 idea 是我的外公为重，然后后来才是慢慢的去谈到了原住民社群的问题。So
basically, he started this project simply to document his grandfather, and he eventually moved on and touched on the subjects and issues of the indigenous communities as a whole. Okay?
So how much were you aware of what was happening to the indigenous people, of their history, before you started filming? How much were you aware of that history? Was it something talked about in your family? Was it something that you were already involved as an activist, as a...
Okay, 他问的是...
他的问题就是说,在拍摄之前, 你对于原住民在20世纪所经历到的历史有多少的认识? 你是透过了家庭内的一种口传的讲述而得知, 或者是您本身就是一个原运动者?
我应该是比较接近前者吧，就是我是在拍摄的过程中慢慢的去发掘到这件事情，就是我一开始的拍摄的想法其实真的非常单纯，我就是想拍摄一个人跟大自然之间的关系。那在拍摄之前，你对原住民有任何的认识吗？就历史这样子？我对那个原运的历史只有很初阶的认识，并没有那么仔细的研究。
Right. So before this project, his understanding, his knowledge about the well-being and the history of the indigenous peoples in Taiwan was relatively little. And this project allowed him to look into the history and the issues. So basically, it's a sort of a to learn through doing kind of approach.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So I was fascinated why you opted for your grandfather and why you decided to tell the stories through a male character when in indigenous culture, it's very much the woman usually doing the transmission. So why did you decide to go for a male character and not a female one?
Okay. 这个跟每个部落的性质有点关系吧， 因为泰鲁格的社群里面就是通常的主要的发声的对象是男性，男性啊，这样说。 所以 那时候我的外祖母其实年轻的时候也跟我外公一起工作在干嘛，可是他的主要的任务吧，应该就是跟着在旁边协助，或者是在家里带小孩，比较不是赚钱养家的角色。当然我也明白在这方面也很重要，所以在这个纪录片里面，其实我觉得他还是存在的，只是他是比较一个在背后的方式，因为 在拍摄这个纪录片的过程，他其实已经过世了好几年，所以我相信如果他还在，他可能也会是这个故事的一部分。可是其实我并没有，就是在这个时间点，我并没有办法很完整的去拍摄到我的祖母的影像，所以 其实我一直觉得有点可惜吧，就是在他还没有过世的时候，我并没有手上没有一些怎么说那种 archive 的东西去做一点记录。
Right. So, the indigenous societies in Taiwan are not necessarily patriarchal. So, take Dalogo, the ethnic tribe to which his maternal grandfather belongs. It is a matriarchal society, a patriarchal society. Okay. And so, it's the man who played the role of to pass the culture and the information onto the next generation.
Sure.
And his maternal grandmother, instead, offered assistance and working at home to bring up the children. She basically works behind the scene.
Okay.
And one more thing he wants to put is when he was conducting this project, his maternal grandfather, grandmother was already deceased.
Mm-hmm.
So if she had been alive, she would have been included in this project.
Mm-hmm.
And he feels pity that he does not have any archival images to talk about his maternal grandmother.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
Yeah. And your grandfather's interesting character, but he comes across as being more like a hermit than being part of a community of, you know, an indigenous community. Is that kind of exceptional? I mean, or do men tend to live more like, you know, little hermits? Do you understand the question?
I'm going to do the translation, okay? Right.
Yeah.
那您的祖父在片中他扮演一个非常有趣的一个角色，也就是说他好像是一个离群所居的隐士，他似乎不属于一个原住民的社群，而原住民社群理论上好像喜欢接种而居这样子，所以为什么会有这样的现象？这是一个普世的现象，还是单纯是您外祖父他的选择呢？
这个比较像是他的选择，因为他其实年纪很大了，然后其实我有很多的亲戚都住在附近，然后我的舅舅吧，他其实是有一段时间他是想要把我的外公接到家里住的，但实际上他们也一起生活了一段时间，可是我外公就是他每住个两三天他就受不了在山下，他就要跑回去他在山上的那个鸡公寮那边，所以后来我舅舅就觉得，好啦，既然你这么希望住在山上，那他就把那个，他就在山上的那个旧房子接了水，接了电，就让我外公自己一个人生活在那边。那我想这样子对他们两边都是比较自在的吧。
Right. So, his maternal grandfather decides to live alone, and in fact.His relatives live nearby in the plain, a little bit away from the mountains. And for example, the director's mother's siblings always wanted to bring Teimu to live with them in the plain, but he found this kind of gregarious life is a little bit difficult. And he...always wants to live alone in the mountain. And so the director's uncle helped Daimu, who is the subject of the documentary, to install electricity and water. I think that is a very good arrangement for the family, and the relatives respect his choice.
Sounds typical.So tell us a little bit about the current situation with indigenous people. what are the protests still going on? Are they getting better rights? I mean, what is at stake?
在问我原住民现在的权益的状态，对对对，
然后有哪一些重要的社会议题这样子，然后他们的状他们是还好呢还是很不好呢这样子。
因为前几年嘛，蔡英文做了一个跟原民道歉的这个动作，所以看似好像要对原民的一些潜力在有些提升，可是这个状况呢，当遇到比如说我们在讨论关于人民自治，或者是在讨论那个叫什么传统领域的问题的时候，因为很容易牵涉到其他族群的利益，那这个时候人民的利益又显得不是，就人民的权益又显得不是那么重要了，所以那个传统领域的议题就卡在那边。那其他的状态的话，我自己是觉得，我们早些年会看到很多的纪录片在谈论的都是原民在对外的抗争，可是近几年我自己发现到一个状况是，这些抗争慢慢的回到部落内部去了，意思是有一些人被改变了他们的生活习惯以后，反而会跟自己部落的内部有一些抗争，比如说以我们讲那个雅尼的例子来说吧，就是有的人会觉得说 OK 我想要拿，因为他们早些年被欺骗签了那个协议，所以就 被那个他们的土地就被拿来做开挖，然后当他们现在想要拿回来的时候，可是另外一批人就是一样是部落里面的人在讨论，他们就会觉得 OK 现在雅尼给了我们整个家族工作机会，让我们有很好的那个发展，所以 OK 我觉得让他继续在这边是没问题的，然后他们雅尼那边也会释放很多的利益给原民的部落，比如说常常办一些什么同乐会啊之类的，过年过节米粮啊那些全部都会来，那这就变成部落内部的冲突了。
Right. So a few years ago, the president of Taiwan, Tsai Ing-wen, she offered official apologies for the sufferings of the indigenous peoples in the last few decades. And this kind of official apology marks the symbolic progress of the civil rights of the indigenous people in Taiwan. However, when it comes to the questions of self-governance and especially the land justice, something needs to be done because these two issues are also related to the welfare of other ethnic groups. And so these two issues are very difficult for the Taiwanese society at the moment. And when director watches older documentaries on indigenous people in Taiwan, he has a very interesting observation. In these much older documentaries, he found out that the movement in the past was basically on the tension between the indigenous society and the mainstream society in Taiwan. So the conflict and the protest is rather external. But in recent years, this kind of movement shifted from the big cities into the indigenous tribes. And he used an example. In the east side of Taiwan, in a village very close to where his maternal grandfather lives, there is a cement factory built very close to a national park. And there is a tension within the indigenous tribe just next to the factory. While some indigenous people in that village are very happy about the existence of the factory because the company offers some subsidies and offer food and resources, scholarship, and some infrastructure to the village. Others feel the factory has detrimental impact on the environmental protection and could lead to the destruction of the village. So there is some disagreement within the indigenous communities.
Yes.
Okay.
Very, very interesting. I've been filming a lot of indigenous communities in different parts of Africa. And it's, you know, when you film over 10 years or so, it's fascinating to see the destruction of the indigenous culture, all the benefits coming in from the outside tend to sacrifice other parts of the culture. One danger that I have seen in such situation is in relation to the rituals, where it all becomes a little bit like a show for tourists, as opposed to keeping the meaning of the culture within those rituals. Are you finding the same thing in the community of your grandfather?
他的问题就是说，像比如说阿美族，他的阿美族奉年祭变成了一个样板，对外宣扬这样子，变成了台湾的大外宣。那这种状况，那就失去了他原来的那个奉年祭的意思了。那这种状况也出现在泰鲁格族吗？
我觉得多多少少会有，因为很大家现在如果去花莲，然后就会看到，我们还是有一些叫有一些对外的祭典，比如说感恩祭之类的，像那样就是一个，但其实我去问了我的外公说，早年有没有这样的东西，说 no，就是日本人带来的，那日本带来，从前的祭典就是自己家里自己办的，他说那个是那些舞蹈啊，很多都是根本就是为了日那时候日本人为了聚集部凝聚部落的乡亲，才来从事这些活动。
This is in Taiwan, but more obvious in other ethnic tribes. But it also exists in the Talogo tribe his grandfather belongs to. And he used an example. In his village, there's a kind of a Thanksgiving ritual. And the local organizations and the authorities welcome external people from other communities to visit them. But the director wants to talk to his grandfather. His grandfather said, this ritual was in fact invented by the Japanese people before the Second World War. It was used by the Japanese people to cement the collective identity of the Taloko tribe. So it was kind of an invented tradition. Okay?
That's another interesting point, because what's been studied in relation to indigenous communities is the shift going from a collective approach to the community to an individual approach to the community. Modernity is strongly associated with being individuals and only wanted to look after yourself and not after the community. Is your community in danger of such kind of shift?
So could you ask your question again, Noel, please?
Yes, I'm saying that you know, research, anthropological research, shows that indigenous communities, as they get touched by modernity, they shift from being a collective community to becoming an individual community. So I was wondering at what stage your community is. Are they still looking after the collective, or are they kind of, you know, in danger of being an individualistic society?
也就是说在他认为说在过去原住民的社群是一个多人的凝聚的一个组织，但是由于在现代性这个现代社会当中，由于个人主义至上， 而瓦解了，间接的瓦解了这个原住民社会的这个集体主义。
有的。
OK， 那这种状况也出现在泰鲁格族吗？
泰鲁格族的状况，
就是你祖父的，
我知道，就是这个问题，我觉得我们自己，我自己的族群啊，比起其他的族群来说，相对那个连接性是比较没那么强的，因为早年的时候，我们并不是以部落为单位，而是比较以家族为单位再去执行这些，不管是祭仪也好，或者是狩猎的活动也好，对，所以
家庭的那个有被个人主义瓦解了。
家庭的话，一直到现在，我都觉得还是有那个位，还是有那些关系存在。
OK，
它并没有那么的说变得个人化，
okay.
就是家人之间的连接还是蛮够的。
Mm-hmm. Right. So the Telugu society is slightly different from other indigenous peoples,
mm-hmm.
because their society is built on individual families instead of villages or communities.
Okay.
And however, even up to the present, the authority of the family is still fairly strong. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Okay, interesting. Another aspect of indigenous people is their relationship with time. And in your film, you certainly take time to be with your grandfather, and he takes time to do things. I mean, there's a real kind of luxury of time. Modernity, of course, changes that. People's relationship with time shifts also radically. Do you feel that what you captured with your grandfather is already the past, or do you think that people will still go on living with that luxury of time?
他的问题也就是说，在过去原住民社会，就是说在你的影片当中，很显然有那个时间性，就是说你花了这么长的时间来拍摄你的外祖父，然后你的外祖父也花了很长的时间只做一件事情，而对他来说，这是一个原住民社会他们特有的一种奢侈，是我们对所没有办法享受的东西，而现代性摧毁了这种享受，对我们一般来说大众是这样子。而同样的这种现代性的摧毁也发生在泰鲁格族吗？还是他们依然相对的比较悠闲自在呢？
影响是一定有的。
嗯哼，
就是很多的我的亲戚，就是比如我的舅舅啊，我的舅妈，或者是我妈这一类的，这一辈的人呢，他们已经相当现代化了。比如说，他们都有各自的，就是在部落里面就是两个大项，要么是公务员，要么是军人。
嗯，
然后他们不是去当老师，不是去考了一个往那个怎么说，初阶的公务员，或者高一点的高补考那样子，然后他们就通常会去做这，因为不然就是比较不会念书，就会去当职业军人。
嗯哼，
就是往这几个方向去当做是一个想要寻求一个安稳的生活了。就是早年的那些观念，一直到部落都还看得到，就是要以军工教为主的那个，
是的，
现在都还是这个观念很重的。
那他们运用时间的概念跟你的祖父有什么？
就是意思是他们已经不再去上山打猎，不再有那样子的务农那样的生活，所以基本上这样子的时间，或者说跟大自然相处的那个时间已经被大大的简化了。
So basically, the luxury of the time, in the Telugu society, is decreasing. And the director uses the people of his mother's generation as an example. So the people of his mother's generation are fairly assimilated into the mainstream society, and they take the steps expected by the mainstream society, for example, to become school teacher, mm-hmm. and or to become civil servants. And if they do not do well in school, they usually end up in the military school, okay? Mm-hmm. And they have stopped doing the activities undertaken by Taimu, the subject of the documentary. Mm. Okay?
Interesting. Okay. So I'm assuming that you must have screened the film to the community. How was it received?
他的问题就是说，他相信说你一定有把这支影片放给你祖父的部落的族人一起看。 那他们的反应是？
我当然拍完的时候，我就先拿去给我外公看了。然后很有趣的反应就是，我外公一开始根本就认不出来那是他自己，他就想说这是哪一个台湾族的人还是哪里嘛。嗯哼。那他一直到那个山，他到那个山上，他看到那个公寮，他才说哦，这个是我嘛，对不对？嗯、他到那个地方才认出来。然后他对于 怎么说？他这个片子跟他平常在看的东西是很不一样的。他平常喜欢看的是一些什么摔跤啊，什么名士这类的东西，所以对他来说，这个是一个他不太会去、平常不太会去接触的东西。对，所以他没有太多的评论。然后关于我的我爸妈，我关于我舅舅或者我妈他们在看的时候，就会觉得，我比较像是在做一个 文化保存的东西，因为其实我外公的生活跟他们基本上都不太一样，那他们觉得我是在做一个文化活动，而不是在做很，而不是他们不觉得那个是一个电影，跟他们平常看的电影也不一样。Okay, great.
Okay, so after the finalization of this project, he showed this film to his grandfather, and his grandfather found the character in the film absolutely unrecognizable. And he thought the old man in that film is probably an old person from another indigenous group in the south side of Taiwan. And he only recognized himself when he saw the shed he lives in the mountain. And this film offers an extraordinary and very strange experience to his grandfather, because his grandfather, on the daily basis, he watches Japanese wrestling, and he also watches Hokkien speaking TV shows. It was very interesting to him. And then the director showed the film to his relatives, like his mother, his uncles, and for them, what he is doing with this project is, instead of like a film, it's rather like a cultural preservation. Because this documentary is very different from the movies they normally see. Okay?
Yeah, I'm sure it must have been fascinating for them. One last question, sorry, before we move on to questions asked by the audience. I want to know about the archive that you used. I mean, beautiful archive, but I'm curious, who shot that archive? Where did you find it? Because who would have been interested in indigenous community before?
Okay. Mm-hmm. 那个新闻史料都是以前的，台影新闻的那个，就是以前的中影制片厂去拍的，但是那都是以前的政勋的新闻的一部分。然后现在这些资料都会在现在的国家电影中心里面，你可以去找得到。当然你要使用就要付费。那当然也不会管你是不是原住民，那个版权就是在他们那边。所以刚才有个问题是讲到
那个原住民可不可以使用这些东西这些影像？嗯哼
，Nope，我们不能，一样要付费。嗯哼
So the footage included in this documentary comes from the central motion pictures, which was a sort of a movie studio established by the KMT party. Mm-hmm. And it had a sort of a propaganda purpose. And now these films are preserved in the Taiwan Film and Audiovisual Institute, the institute that offers the most films we have in this festival. Mm-hmm. And so you need to apply and join the membership and also pay some basic fees if you want to access these resources. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Was it difficult to get the rights to use that footage in a very different context than what it was meant when it was shot?
Could you say a little bit more about your question?
Was it difficult for you to get copyrights of that footage, considering that you are going to use the archive in a very different context than what it was meant for? Mm-hmm.
就是你基本上去申请都是可以的，那你要申请使用，当然它会依据你使用的目的不同，会有不同的跟你的使用的长度，然后它会有不同的价位嘛，应该这样说，它是有一个、okay. 有一个非常公定的价位，在网络上是可以找得到的。
Okay, right. The access to the resources is not difficult. You just need to apply to the institute.And however, you need to tell them your purpose, and the reason of the usage of the resources, and the fees are subject to the purposes and the length of the film used in your project. And all the information can be found on the website of the institute. Okay?
Okay, great. Thank you. So we've now got questions from the audience. Let's take them one by one. So the first one, have there been many other films, projects undertaken in Taiwan about indigenous communities? Do you see documentary filmmaking as a vehicle for change in wider Taiwanese society? So let's take the first part of that question.Any other films about indigenous communities in Taiwan?
这什么意思啊？第一个就是说，就是有没有其他的那个原住民那个纪录片的工作者，以及或者是类似的拍摄计划呢
？OK， 当然有，台湾还是有其他的原民的纪录片导演，甚至也有原民的拍剧情长片的导演，都有的。
OK， 所以不止。那个纪录片这样子，
对，不是纪录片。
Okay. Right, so there are numerous projects, and there are many filmmakers in Taiwan with indigenous background, and there are not
many, not so many.
Okay, so there are not there are some, but they are not.
I can count it with my hand.
Okay,
5, 6.
Right, and they are not limited to the field of documentary.
Okay.
So there are some filmmakers working on drama pictures, for example.
Maybe one or two person.
Yeah.
And the second part of the question, do you see documentary as a vehicle for change in Taiwanese society?
也就是说，他的问题是，你是否觉得这个纪录片在台湾是一种用来改变社会运动的一种工具。
我觉得这样子看纪录片会稍微有一点狭隘吧。就是怎么说呢？我每次在做影像创作的时候，第一个想的一定不会是 OK， 我要用这个片去改变什么事情。那第一个想法一定是。我有一些话想要说，我觉得这个想法很重要，我想要用影片去传达，而比起那个，我觉得用影像去有那个社会的功能，那是它的附加价值而已。
Mm-hmm. Right. He feels it's a little bit unfair to limit the function of documentary to the field of making social change. Mm-hmm. And he uses himself as an example. When he was making the film, when he's about to make the film, what he has in his mind is not to create a social change, but instead, he has some ideas he wants to share with audiences. And for him, the social change is rather the consequence or the byproduct. Okay?
Yeah, very good. So, second question, have you always been close to your grandparents, or is this film an opportunity for you to get to know more about them?
它比较像是第二个说法，就是其实它比较是一个机会吧。嗯、在因为在此之前，其实我跟我外公，距离都蛮远的，我并没有跟他一起生活。嗯、然后我一直被放在讲闽南语的地区，嗯、所以我的闽南语讲的比母语好很多。那、嗯、一直到我开始进行这个计划，我才有比较多的时间。在花莲、嗯、然后去跟他相处。
Okay. So it is more like this project offers an approach and an opportunity to know more about his maternal grandfather. And before this project, their relationship was not very close becausethe director was brought up in a Hokkien-speaking society with his father.
Yes, so it was an opportunity then to get closer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. The next question is linked to cinematography. Cinematography is very calm, very restrained in your film, and sometimes even a bit distant. You don't use many interviews, you don't use much dialogue. Could you explain a little bit about your approach to telling the story visually?
安静的，然后拘谨的，甚至你跟那个拍摄者有产生一定的距离，而其中没有任何的访谈，没有任何的对话。为什么
？I mean, we already touched in many aspects of that, but maybe just a summary.
就简要来说，因为他会问更多相关的问题。
OK， 因为。其实在最初的时候我们还是有做一些访谈有一些对话的，只是在后期的拍摄的时候、嗯、我觉得与其让他用他的语言去讲他的故事，不如用他的生活，用他的动作 去讲述这件事，因为我觉得他的过去的那些经验都已经潜藏在他的现在的状态里面、嗯、所以我就把那些访谈的东西全部抽离，而我把它写成了，我把那些访谈写成了像是，更有诗意的口白写在里面。其实，所以我其实严格上来说，它还是存在，只是转换了一个形式而已。
So the interview was in fact conducted in the very beginning of this project.
Mm-hmm.
But he eventually decided to take.The interviews away from the film. Because for him, in his perspective, instead of asking his grandfather to use his native language to share his experience from the past, his experience and his knowledge from the past is actually already revealed in his physical movement and in his everyday life. And he, the director, uses poetic narration to represent the result of the interview he had done in the very beginning of the shooting. Okay?
Okay. So tell us, why are you working in documentary? What's so, why are you passionate about documentary as a form?
其实我有拍剧情片，就是对他也，其实对我来说吧，剧情片啊、纪录片啊，甚至实验片啊，他们都只是一个形式的分别吧。然后对，我觉得电影就是电影，当他拍，当他成，那个氛围出来，它就是了，不管它什么形式，都是这样的。所以，就其实我现在正在，我已经写完了一个剧情 长片的剧本，那我可能会在明后年去拍摄它。然后手边也还有另外一支纪录片的计划在进行。所以我觉得我会这么说的，去尽量去开阔那个可能性，我不会把自己框架在只有拍纪录片的市场。但它是一个怎么说，算是一个原点，因为每次当我拍纪录片的时候，它都像是一个填掉的过程，让我在之后写剧本也好，干嘛都有更充足的营养去做这些事。
Right. In fact, I'm the director. In addition to documentary, he also works on motion pictures and other different forms of the filmmaking.
As director or editor?
As a director or editor?
As director or editor. Director.
Both. Okay. And for him, the formalistic difference is not the most significant issues. After all, they are movies. So as long as they can convey the ambience, they are successful movies. And at the moment, he just finished a script writing, and he plans the script will become a film in 2 to 3 years. And he is also working on a documentary at the moment. And this, he does not want to narrow himself in any specific film genre. And instead, he wants to widen the possibilities and his scope. And for him, a very important thing to say is documentary is the source of many different film genres, because he needs to do research.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah. I think that's an excellent answer. It definitely promotes documentary as storytelling and not as factual programming. So I'm completely with you on this one. Well, I think that's all we've got time. We're coming to the end of our session. Thank you so much for sharing your practice, sharing your thoughts kind of, you know, with us. It's been really, really interesting. And good luck with the next kind of two projects, the fiction and the documentary. Hopefully we'll have it kind of, you know, in Edinburgh with Taiwan Film Festival. And hopefully we'll get a chance to meet you directly kind of, you know, next time round. So thank you. And thank you for the lovely translation behind the scene.
Thank you.
I think it should be here.
You keep traveling from different places.
Yes, I'm running around.
Yes.
Thank you for all your question and all the audience. It's a really nice experience. I've never
I've never been to Scottish and I've never talked to a Scot. So actually, about my project, I think the documentary will be finished in the next February. And yeah, but the fiction will be a long project, so I think it's a few times.
We have two great kind of international festivals in Scotland, one in Edinburgh and one in Glasgow. The one in Edinburgh is in June, and the one in Glasgow is in February. So if you're finishing the film in February, apply to Edinburgh for June. And hopefully we'll see the film in cinema.
Of course, I'll check the information and try to submit the film festival, of course.
Yeah, I'm sure you can help you with that.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you very much. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye.